Hi, my name's Jeff Jones, director of the Big Blue Band in Mesquite, Texas. A while back, I had a completely original, somewhat borrowed idea to pick up the best of the best and drive them around in my wife's Honda Odyssey minivan. This is Maestros and Minivans. Today's guest is the world-renowned trumpet player, Mr. Chris Martin. Mr. Martin is currently serving as the principal trumpet of the New York Philharmonic and served previously for a decade in that role with the Chicago Symphony. Prior to that, Mr. Martin's performed with the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra and the Philadelphia Orchestra. Many of you are also familiar with his work as the iconic trumpet soloist in John Williams' score to the movie Lincoln.
All right, well, this is it. You're here.
This is the minivan.
This is the one.
This is a lot of pressure. A lot of people have been in this seat.
True. But today it's your day.
And not all wearing diapers.
Not all of them. Some of them. I didn't know. Did Junkin tell you that story?
Did Jerry wear diapers?
I don't want to answer that. You ask him specifically.
Okay, I'll ask him. Okay.
We're honored to have with us in the van today the one and only, the principal trumpet of the New York Philharmonic, Mr. Chris Martin.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
It's great to be here.
Thanks for being here. Appreciate it.
Great to be in the van.
You're just doing the concerto thing tonight.
Right? Just a concerto, and we may do an encore.
Cool.
We may do the little piece from Lincoln that John Williams wrote for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Malice Toward None. We may play that. It just depends how it all goes.
I was going to ask you about that. How did all that come together?
The Lincoln piece?
Yes.
When Spielberg made that movie,
yes,
he shot that movie, Lincoln. John Williams had this idea that since Lincoln was from Illinois, mm-hmm. and since Illinois was the first state to ratify the 13th Amendment, that it would be appropriate for an orchestra from Illinois to record the music.
Cool.
And he has a long relationship with Chicago Symphony, so I think my understanding is he pitched it to Spielberg, and he was all in.
Cool.
And so that's how the recording happened. And then the piece, just literally one day I got an email from his publisher saying, "Hey, John wrote this piece for you. Let me send you a draft and see what you think." And I said, "Oh, okay, that sounds great." And it's beautiful, and I've played it a bunch of times, mostly with my wife actually on piano.
Okay.
It's nice. It's really beautiful. It's 3 or 4 minutes. Mm-hmm. And mostly lyrical and very beautiful, but it's also tough. It's a tricky thing. Like he has this way of writing. He has this way of writing that's natural. You know, especially for brass, it's natural, but also like completely naked feeling. Somehow, yeah. Well, so,
I would think there's got to be a lot of moments like that in the first trumpet world.
Yeah.
So how do you manage that?
You just got to be comfortable being naked in front of people. That's the main thing. emotionally naked.
Oh, right. Good clarification.
Yeah. Not physically naked.
Yes, got it.
no, it's true. I mean, you have to. The thing with performing in any capacity is there is an element of the unknown, right?
Sure.
And you have to be comfortable with that. You know, especially playing a brass instrument, especially playing a trumpet, and especially playing a first trumpet position, there's always, no matter how much you practice, no matter how much you prepare for every eventuality, you can never be 100% certain of the outcome. And you have to be okay with that little bit of excitement, you know? And so that's the first thing.
Sure.
Just accept that. That's part of the deal. But that's also what makes it exciting. And if you look at that and that makes you afraid, that's okay. That's normal. But if you can turn that into, either positive energy or aggressive energy, it works. You know, that's the thing. Is you got to turn. If you have negative thoughts or anxiety, you got to flip that into some kind of strength for yourself.
What's your trick on that? Do you have one?
Yeah, it's good to get. Sometimes it's good to be angry when you play. I had a former colleague in Chicago who told me that. He said, sometimes getting mad works well, and it does actually. It's hard for me to get angry, but you can pretend. I tell students a lot that when you go on stage, it helps to have another personality that you feel you can step into. And, you know, if you're a nice person, mild-mannered, kind of quiet, maybe shy, then in a way, it can be even easier to do a 180 and decide, okay, when I'm on stage, I'm going to be, you know, Captain Aggressive. You know, I'm going to be hyper-confident. And my old teacher at Eastman, Charlie Geyer, told me, you know, body language, it makes a huge difference. And, you know, if you're feeling a little tentative, if you're feeling a little shy, then hold yourself as if you are. You know, sit in the chair confidently, not overly confident, you know, not super stiff like your sixth grade band director told, or my sixth grade band director told me, you know, straight back against the, you know, chair. And that's not good for, you know, that's not good for anything, but especially in playing a brass instrument. But, you know, sit back, look confident, you know, and if you look like you know what you're doing, then eventually you start to believe that, I know what I'm doing. I've got this. So body language goes a long way toward sort of reprogramming your brain when it comes to, you know, fighting nerves and fighting anxiety or any of that. And then, but again, you know, the other thing is, you know, when the time comes to play the lick, you just got to let it go. You know, you got to trust in your work and let it go. And if it's great, great. And if it doesn't go so well, then afterward, then you can think about, okay, what happened? What did I do? It's fun. Yeah. And sometimes for me, it's, you know, if I make a mistake or if something's not quite right the way I want it, sometimes if my head wasn't in the right place, sometimes it's just as simple as, like, I set wrong or I took the wrong breath. You know, sometimes it's something as simple as that. It has nothing to do with, you know, I mean, like any big ideas about your personality or your music making or your phrasing. Sometimes it's like, hey, man, just, you know, take a smaller breath and that fixes it.
Okay, smart. Yeah. Let's go back and kind of start.
Sure.
I'm just interested in tracing your past a little bit, your history. So, did you come from a musical family?
I do, yeah. My father is a band director.
Yep.
He turned 70 this year. He's still going. Still teaching.
Georgia, is that right?
Yeah, outside Atlanta. He teaches at a school, and his school doesn't have marching bands, so he's still coaching for marching bands around just because he loves it. And he's still doing drum and bugle corps in the summertime. I grew up in that world. I grew up, my babysitters were marching band kids, and mothers are marching band kids. And
right.
I lived a large portion of my baby life, you know, in a car seat at marching band rehearsals or drum and bugle corps rehearsals. So, my father started a corps called Spirit of Atlanta back in 77 or so. So I spent every summer until I was about 10 years old on the road touring with the drum corps. So I grew up hearing brass from the beginning. My father's, he's a horn player.
All the great ones are. Right. I'm just going to throw that out there. You choose to disagree.
All the great ones are horn players?
All the great ones are horn players. That's been my experience.
That's what horn players always say, isn't it?
Good point. Okay, go ahead.
Of course, that's what trumpet players would say, too.
Yeah, but they'd be wrong. No? Okay.
so he wanted, you know, I think we had horns around the house. I think he really wanted, you know, me to play the horn. So I started on the horn. But after a month or so, it wasn't really for me. And the notes are too close together, and the case is big, and it was a pain to carry it, you know. Got to carry it on the bus, and I'm like, trumpet's much smaller, shinier.
Sure. Many are called, few are chosen. That's fine. Go ahead.
That's right. I remember my dad gave me a lecture when I told him I wanted to switch. I was really nervous to have this conversation. You know?
Sure.
Tell him that I didn't want to play the horn. And he gave me a talk about how many more trumpet players there are than horn players. A lot more good trumpet players than there are good horn players, and the more horn, you know, there's more gigs for horn, so you stand in an orchestra, you know, there's more chairs, more gigs for horn. But I was a firstborn kid and trying to find my own way, and
right.
I foolishly ignored his advice, and now here I am playing a trumpet.
Yeah, but I'm going to say it seems like it's turned out okay for you.
It has been okay. I've been very fortunate. And I've actually been really lucky to have parents who are musical and who are so supportive. My mom is a she's a vocalist and plays piano, and she was a choral teacher early in her life, and she still sings. She sings in the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra's chorus. That was Robert Shaw's chorus.
Yeah.
And so I had from the beginning parents who were, they didn't push it on me,
sure,
which I think is the best way for your child to find passion. I think it, but they showed it to me, introduced it to me, and encouraged me to go as far as I could. But they allowed me to make that choice, and that's to me the best way to parent. Being a parent myself now, I think about this all the time. So I wouldn't be here at all if it weren't for them. There's no way.
How old were you when you were experimenting with the horn? When you got, when you started on the trumpet? Like what age were you?
Yeah, I was 9. Okay. Turning 10.
Yeah.
It was all summer birthday. So.
Were you in your dad's high school band?
No, he actually, when I was in high school, he had taken a break from teaching. He was doing business, but I was in my uncle's high school band.
Okay.
So my father's older brother was my high school band director, but my father was also around doing a lot of teaching at the brass. So. Yeah.
And then from there to Eastman, is that right?
That's right. Yeah. I did undergrad at Eastman. 4 years there, I took a bunch of auditions, mostly orchestra auditions when I was in undergrad. I got close a couple times, sort of close, but never really, I didn't get anything.
Got it.
And so I finished Eastman, and I had a kind of a trial coming for an orchestra in Buffalo,
okay.
Buffalo Phil. But I'd auditioned for grad school at Juilliard, because I wanted to study with Phil Smith.
Sure.
And I got waitlisted at Juilliard. I didn't get in. And so I went into the summer after I graduated with no real options. Maybe a trial in Buffalo, maybe, but no grad school and nothing. And so I was really looking at, like, what am I going to do? You know? Looking at going back home with the parents to practice, sort it out, you know, work a job. So I was really, I was highly motivated, even more than I had been before.
Sure.
I ended up doing a little stint at the New World Symphony down in Miami.
Okay.
For a couple weeks, and then on the way to this Buffalo trial thing, there was an audition in Philly for Philly Orchestra, and I'd never heard the Philadelphia Orchestra live back then. I'd heard them on tons of records, of course,
sure.
But never live. I didn't know Dave Bilger, the principal trumpet, or anybody in the orchestra. I'd never met him. So, but it was on the way, and it was right before the Buffalo thing. So I thought, okay, works out. So I applied. They let me in, and I stopped there, you know, a few days before the Buffalo thing, and I played, and, you know, I had pressure, but not the sort of pressure like I, you know, play it for my teacher or a bunch of people I know, or, you know,
right,
a town I really want to live in.
Right.
It's a great city, but I have no idea about Philly. Other than, like, cheesesteaks and the Eagles fans always fight each other. That's all I knew about.
Got it. I think that's all there is. You may have gotten it all.
I lived there for 3 years, and it was a little more than that.
Okay. Good to know.
It's good pizza places there. So, yeah, I went and I played, and every day I played, and I thought, you know, okay, I played pretty well, but probably I'm not going to get this job. It was associate principal. It's a big kick, you know? I was 22. And every day I played the first round, and they let me through, and I was like, well, cool. First round, okay. You know, I've done that before, so I get that. And then I played in the second round, and it was a little longer, maybe 20, 30 minutes of playing. And I played pretty well, but I had a couple things, you know, that weren't perfect, and I thought, no, that's it. And I got through to the finals, and I thought, whoa, this could maybe happen. And I thought, no, this is not going to, there's no way it's going to happen. And then I played the final, and you know, I played two rounds in the final, which is normal. Most orchestras, if you play in the final, usually you'll play a couple times.
Okay.
And played the first round, and I played really well. And I got to the last bit, and it was just me and another guy. And I ended up getting the gig. I couldn't believe it. Yeah, so I was in Philly for 3 years.
So you ended up, let's be clear, you ended up at the Philadelphia Symphony because it was on the way to Buffalo.
Yeah.
That's how all this transpired.
Yeah.
At 22.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah.
Great.
So you never know. I mean, it's true. You really never know. Like,
right?
You never know how life's going to take you. And it's kind of a 22-year-old kid. I got into Philadelphia Orchestra and playing a great job. I got to play, you know, a decent amount of first trumpet. with the Philly Orchestra. And yeah, it was amazing. It was the most amazing time to play with Dave Bilger, an amazing guy, an amazing player, an amazing teacher. It was the best like secondary education I could have possibly hoped for. And after 3 years there, another of my former teachers, Jim Thompson, left the Atlanta Symphony, my old hometown band, and went to Eastman to replace my other teachers who left Eastman to go to Northwestern. So like musical chairs, you know.
Sure.
It always happens. Happens in the band director world too, right, of course.
Seems to happen in the orchestral trumpet world too.
Yeah, it does, yeah. It does happen a lot.
Okay.
And yeah. So I was in Atlanta. I went to Atlanta.
Okay.
Was in Atlanta for 5 years, played in my old hometown band. That was fun. Then went to Chicago in 2005. After a few auditions, not making it, I finally got in. And I was there 11 years. And I've been now in New York it's my first year in New York. So I've been really lucky. I mean, I'm really lucky and really fortunate to, you know, I think about my own, like, the thing that I trace it all back to is, one, like I said, having parents who were supportive and who helped me find the right path, and having a tremendous first teachers who helped me find my sound and find the best sound I can make. And that's all we focused on. We didn't, for years with my old teachers, we work on technique and articulation and flexibility studies and Clark and all that stuff. But mostly what I did was listen to records and listen to great trumpet players, listen to Herseth, listen to Phil Smith, listen to Wynton Marsalis, listen to Tom Stevens, and really sort of grow my sound in my mind and, you know, listen and try to make the best sound I could. And that's what that's the reason why I've been able to do all this. So, like, there are guys who can play faster than me, play higher than me, play, you know, louder than me, I'm sure, but although I don't know, after a year in New York, I can play pretty loud. but it's really the sound. That's really the thing.
And so that's where you found it, was patterning it after the players that you admire.
Yeah, absolutely.
And just hearing, immersing yourself in that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I played along with records so much when I was a student, a young student in college, and I still do it now. You know, if I want a reference, I'll put in an old Herseth recording or a Phil Smith recording, and I'll play along, and I'll really listen, how's my sound balancing out with these guys, and I still do it. And that's the other thing, is you have to, you know, when you go on stage, you got to be confident and you've got to be sure of your ability. But when I'm practicing, I'm always analyzing and trying to break down and trying to think, how can I make this better? What's the problem? What's going on? You know.
So when was it when you felt like, okay, I've nailed it? Here it is. This is what Chris Martin's supposed to sound like. The world's going to stand up and listen.
I'm not 100% happy still with it, to be honest, with my sound, but. It's great, but I've been happy with the way it's developed a lot, and in each stage of my sort of my development.
Sure.
I worked, you know, when I went to Chicago, it was a real shock. You know, the range of sounds you have that those guys play with there. You know, not only dynamic range, but color range, you know, brilliance and brilliance all the way to like a covered, warm, dark, beautiful piano sound. And I worked really hard in my time there to find that spectrum. I always had before, but I had new motivation. So I was really, in a lot of ways, happy with the work I did there and with the work I did with the colleagues there. And I'm really, since I've been in New York, I feel the same way, that it's different. You know, it's not, you know, it's neither. That there's no, I don't know, like, music isn't competition to me. Like, music is, it's not better or worse, it's just different. And I've really enjoyed playing with the guys in New York, guys and ladies in New York, for similar reasons. You know, the color range is huge and the dynamic range is huge. And you know, working on changing the width of my sound and the shape of my sound to fit better with those guys has been fun. I like that project, sort of that tinkering. So, the answer is, I was really, you know, after a couple of years in the Chicago Symphony, I really started to notice a big difference in what I sounded like. And that was exciting to me. But I feel like it keeps continuing, hopefully, you know,
sure,
for as long as you can. You know, eventually, a brass player, trumpet player, you know, eventually you run out of juice, you know, and you stop going up and you eventually start declining a little bit. Except for Doc Severinsen, somehow he doesn't seem to do that at all. You know, and Herseth went on for such a long time too. So I hope to keep doing that as long as I can. as long as it's fun and enjoyable, and as long as I can add something to the band, that's what I'll keep trying to do. So,
can you describe? Do you remember that first moment with the Chicago Symphony Brass? What would, do you have any memories of that first experience? Sure. What was that like?
Yeah, I do. The first time I played with the full brass section was was in an audition, and it was like a visceral experience. Playing the minor fifth opening with them, playing Pictures at an Exhibition. Yeah, really powerful. And the same in New York, the first time I played with the Philharmonic brass section, it was in an audition, and the same thing. And I remember in that audition, the first excerpt I played was Pictures, opening of Pictures at an Exhibition, Mussorgsky. And, a couple bars, you're by yourself, and so I'm like, okay, playing by myself. And then when the full brass comes in, I thought, oh man, this is fun. That was all I thought, like, this is really fun. And it was the same in Chicago. So, you know, every day was fun, I still, most days I can't believe I get to do what I'm doing. It's really silly fun.
So even as a young player, is that what you knew your life was headed for? You're like,
I didn't know that's where I was going, but that's what I wanted.
Yeah.
And that started for me, you know, I grew up in a band.
Sure.
And growing up in Georgia in those days, there really wasn't much of an orchestra program in any of the schools I attended. You know, I think that in my high school, the orchestra had about 15 students, you know, and it's different here in Texas, obviously. Like, you know, every program is amazing, especially in this area. It's really, the music programs are amazing. But those days, there wasn't much of an orchestra, so I didn't really have any experience in the orchestra until I got into a youth symphony my last couple of years, and that was a great experience.
I think I meet a lot of folks who really enjoy the performance aspect of it, but struggle with the practice. Was that ever an issue for you, or just because it was ingrained in the home, it just felt like something everybody did?
That's a good question. You know, I'll be honest with you. Since we're in your minivan, I feel like I can be honest.
Thank you. And honestly, let's be honest, just the two of us are ever going to be here. So, I mean, well, my mom will watch. She likes it a lot. Thanks, Mom.
I have like one student from the old days who might watch it. That's about it.
So okay, good.
Ansel, this is for you. When I was a teenager starting out, I honestly didn't like to practice. I really wasn't into it. I liked to play, and I liked, you know, I liked hearing things get better. But you know, as a kid, it's hard to see the end. You know, when you're 12, 13 years old, it's hard to see. If you put in all this work now and don't go play with your friends outside and don't play baseball anymore, and you know, make sure, you know, means you have to stay up late to do your homework, and you know, you still, you know, maybe someday you can have some success and joy in this thing, maybe, or maybe you won't. It's hard to see that as a kid.
Yeah.
And so I didn't really like it, to be honest, at first, and that was you know, one of the challenges for me. But I owe all credit to my parents and to my great teachers. They said all the right things and kept pushing me and encouraging me and showing me, you know, like you have some ability to do this thing, and if you, you know, and incrementally helping me improve, and eventually, you know, once I got a taste of like, wow, oh my gosh, like this sounds way better than it did last lesson. You know, this actually sounds kind of good now. I think I can maybe do this. Once you get a taste for that, then you realize, okay, this is something I really want. And so it started slow for me. Uh-huh. And I started slow. I was kind of a late bloomer on the trumpet. Like, I didn't make any of the honor bands or district bands or all state until later, really later in high school. I think it's better to develop slowly and do it right. Then I've heard Tom Hooton talk about this before, that he feels like, I don't know, but he feels like he started sort of on the slow side too. He came to the trumpet a little bit later than most kids do. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you look at Tom, how Tom plays now, it sounds, my God, like he clearly did it right. And so it's better to you know, start slow, build your sound slowly, mm-hmm. and let the technique and all that stuff, and the higher, faster, louder, let all that stuff come later. And I still, even in my practice now, my daily practice now, that's still how I start. You know, I start small. I start with finding my sound in a focused way, you know. And then once I've got it, once I find my sound again, then I build it back up. Then I start playing bigger and louder and wider and higher. But for me, every day, and Larry told me in a lesson I had with him as a kid, I was having a really bad day. You know, I think it was a Saturday morning, and we had a football game the night before, and marching band, you know. And I was just having a really bad morning, and wasn't really working. And we worked on some warm-up stuff, and I was really frustrated. And he told me, he said, listen, you know, it doesn't matter if you're 16, or 26, or 56, every trumpet player starts every day from scratch. I remember that almost every single morning, that lesson he told me, because it's true. And some days I get up and I'm like, man, this feels great, I can play anything. Some days I get up and I think, I don't know how I'm going to play a concert tonight. No idea.
And even now, that's still a struggle.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But there are still days you think, I don't know how I'm going to do this. But you remember, everybody goes through it. Everybody. From just starting out in fifth grade, sixth grade, to, you know, being 40 years old and having a great job playing the trumpet. Everybody has those days. But if you stick, with regular practice and good routine and good fundamentals, even, you know, the bad days even out. You know, you end up, your bad days aren't as bad as they used to be.
Was there ever a time when you're like, this is it, I'm going to sell used cars, I'm going to sell some minivans? Was there ever a point in your life where you were just done?
Yeah, there were some times at Eastman that I got so frustrated with not being able to figure something out. I remember I had a time at Eastman where I could not play like a soft high A. I could not do it. And I practiced all the right stuff. Like I practiced, practiced low attacks and high attacks and all around it. And if the chips were down and I had to do it in a piece,
right,
couldn't do it. Splia the thing every time. I almost one day, the practice rooms at Eastman were in this big annex building, and it went up like 8-10 floors.
Okay.
And there was one day that I almost threw my trumpet out the window.
You're making that up. Like you were seriously considering it.
Yeah, yeah. All right. I almost did it. I mean, I was this close. People throw stuff out those windows all the time.
Oh, so that's like a natural occurrence.
There was a parking garage out there.
Okay.
You could look out and you'd see like chairs and music
cello.
Stands.
Yeah,
cello.
Viola.
Somebody did throw a cello out once, actually. I think it was like a student cello or something. Yeah, I mean, there's all kinds of stuff down there. No, it's just a normal part of music school.
Got it. Completely understand.
But I didn't do it. I have thrown my trumpet before, but I've thrown it either at a nice nice plush chair,
sure,
or at the bed or something.
Well, how did you recover from moments like that one? I mean, that's a serious brink for a guy who's at Eastman,
yeah,
who clearly has some talent.
Sometimes you got to take a break. I mean, sometimes you need a break a couple hours. Sometimes you need a day. Sometimes you need a week.
Talk about brass sections like Chicago and the New York Phil.
Yeah.
What makes it fun to play in those sections? What are you looking for as a member of that ensemble to make that an enjoyable day at work for you?
My wife says that because I grew up in the drum corps world, I grew up in this sort of wall of sound, concept.
Yeah.
And that's kind of always what I've been striving for, is to end up in a brass section that had like this sort of unanimity of approach and style and sound. It's, you know, I just, when I sit, you know, in Chicago is that way, in New York it's that way. I'm so lucky to have done the things I've done. For me, it's a sound first, of course, but it's that attitude that you're honest and you're open, but you're also, everybody's working towards something bigger than just your own ego or your own desire.
Right.
That's what it's all about for me.
What are you looking for in a conductor in those environments?
That's a good question. For me, a great conductor is first and foremost attitude, right? The best conductors I've ever played for have been, while huge personalities and sometimes huge egos, they have still been first and foremost for the music and for that performance that day of this piece. And then everything else comes after that. And that's the first thing. But in terms of actual conducting, economy of movement is huge. Conductors who show a lot with small gestures are the greatest, to me, the greatest. Like it's, you know, there's a time for big, huge, you know, downbeats and big, you know, sweeping, you know, mouth agape, screaming to the heavens. There's a time for that. But most of the time, the great conductors, you know, Muti, Haitink, Maribor, Salonen, these guys are, they show so much with such a small area. You know, when I want something really together, it gets smaller, forces everybody to focus in, and smaller but still clear. And so that to me is huge. And not just those conductors, almost any conductor we ever see at the Philharmonic or in the Chicago Symphony has this ability. Those two things are the key.
Okay.
Right attitude and economy of, that's the key.
Talked about drum corps experience a little bit earlier. How has that impacted you? Because I would assume you're probably in the minority among your colleagues of folks who came up through the drum corps ranks and then are in these major symphonic gigs.
Yeah,
so
not that many.
How did that experience impact you?
You know, being a part of something bigger than yourself, which is, you know, the thing that music, one of the greatest things music teaches is not only individual discipline, but individual discipline and self-control as it relates to being part of a group. And there aren't that many opportunities for kids to get that. You know, sort of the world kind of splinters. Everybody keeps, you know, dividing into their smaller and smaller groups and factions and cliques and all these things. And you know, the internet's made it easy for people to just do whatever they want, whenever they want, and not really think about other people and even have to talk to other people.
Right.
You know, something like drum corps, not just drum corps, but something like drum corps forces you to have to get along with other people. There's no, like, there are very few distractions. There are very few opportunities to escape. it's sort of like military school for you know, 2 or 3 months in the summertime, which is, you know, parts of it aren't that much fun at all.
Sure.
Parts of it are really kind of not enjoyable, like, you know, rehearsing outside in Mississippi in August.
Not the best?
Not like the most fun you've ever had in your life.
Sure.
But they're almost every kid who does it, who ends up doing drum and bugle corps, as miserable as they are so many times, covered in mosquitoes and sunburns and all that, well, as soon as it's over, all I want to do is start again.
Right.
Come right back in for the next season. Because it, you know, the discomforts are part of what helps you bond as a group, but it's also the high points, like so many, you know, the working on a show relentlessly, hours and hours every day, and watching it get better and better and better and better, making it the best you can be, regardless of the position you end up at the end of the season. You know, the work you put in matters, and far beyond any competition. Of course, it's great to win things, and it's great to get trophies, and that feels good, but, you know, even at the end, what really matters is the progress and the development and the evolution you make as a person and as a group. And it's hard to find that anywhere else in music. It's really difficult with that degree of intensity. It's tough, even in a great professional situation. You never have the bonding at that level. It just doesn't happen.
You talk about the closeness of the performers and how engaging that is. Is there a connection with the audience that's important to you too?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is that where that addiction came from? The drum corps kind of scene, or is?
Yeah. That's a good word, addiction. Yeah, I didn't use, that's your word, but that's true. And it is. It is. For me, it's an important distinction because I don't play. It's a fine line. Like, I don't play for applause.
Okay.
But at the same time, if there were no people there, why would you be playing? Other than just as a selfish exercise. So. There's absolutely a connection between audience and performer. For me, I play really to give something, to, in a way, to kind of justify all the selfish work I've done for all these years for myself to play the trumpet. And
to have such a great position and to have such a fortunate job, you know, such a blessing of a job. So in a way, to even it out, you know, you have to give back, and you have to do the best you can to give that back to them. And you know, if it goes well and people like it, then that's sort of icing. Sure. But it's like it is. It's an addiction. It's a need to do that. Like, I think rehearsals are interesting versus concerts, because in rehearsals, I never go even into rehearsals thinking totally relaxed, like, oh, it's just a rehearsal, whatever. Because in rehearsal, you're really working intensely with your colleagues, and you can really get into like some serious spats with colleagues in rehearsals if things don't go quite right. And you know, and especially if you're first trumpet, you have real responsibility to play well from the beginning, from the first, like, it's expected you'll play well from the first rehearsal. And that doesn't mean you can't have some issues and work it out, but you got to play your part as best you can first rehearsal. And so there's that dynamic is there. It's intense. But then in a concert, that dynamic is still there, but the audience's presence, there's an energy that kind of lifts everybody up. So I find rehearsals to be kind of clinical and sort of analytical, and then concerts to be still technical in your mind, but there's a real kind of energy that elevates the playing. And a really good band like the CSO, like the New York Philharmonic, Atlanta Symphony, Philly, like a really good band like that, when you're playing for people, and when those people want to be there, hopefully, yeah, you know, sure, they want to be there, that raises everybody's game. The best concerts I've ever played, I can't really remember them. I remember starting them, and I remember finishing thinking, God, that was amazing. I'm not really remembering what happens in between. So it's like one of those moments, everybody's in the zone, everybody's in the moment. You know, Jim Thompson used to call it present time. In my old lessons, I'm sure he still does, but in my lessons, he called it present time. You know, not thinking about this note coming in four bars or in two bars or in one beat, but being right in the moment now, you know. And the best times in your life you have are when you're in that zone.
So, I mean, you list off some incredible accomplishments and opportunities that you've had. Yeah. How'd you know it was time to move on?
Move on to New York?
Those experiences.
Yeah, it's a good question. I sort of knew and I sort of didn't. I never thought I would leave Chicago, to be honest. I was there 11 years. I met my wife there. We had our daughter there. A lot of intense experiences happened in both of our lives there. And it really felt like home to us. And I never thought we would leave. I think I said to you before that, you know, I've always had an idea in my mind of what I was striving for,
sure,
in terms of playing in a brass section. And I think, you know, I fell in love with orchestral music, and I fell in love with that world. But what I really love, my first passion, is brass playing. And my first love is brass playing, and playing in a great trumpet section, playing in a great brass section, and I had that in Chicago, and it was amazing. And I went to New York and played with those guys, and it was, for me, it was not better. It was just, it felt natural. It really felt natural. And it really felt like, you know, in with respect to the attitude and the way that they played, you know, it just felt natural. My wife says it's like, 'cause it sounds more like drum corps. I'm like, in a good way, and maybe that's true. You know, maybe that's kind of true in a way. I don't know, but
it just felt like home.
It just felt like home, yeah.
Well, kind of in a midpoint here. Maybe there's still an awful lot of music making left to do. But what's been the most special so far for you? If you had to pick out something that's made it special for you, what's made it special? Mm.
So many great concerts I can think of. There, I remember, I remember the not long into my
not long into my time in the Philly Orchestra, doing the Mahler Second with Simon Rattle in Carnegie Hall. It was an incredible experience, just to sort of like a constantly pinching myself, like, am I really here doing this, you know? And I remember recording the first actual professional recording I ever made was with Atlanta, the Mahler First Symphony, with the extra blue Mina movement that has a nice, beautiful trumpet solo. Mm-hmm. That was a moment I remember thinking, I can't believe I'm doing this, you know? And then playing with the CSO, I remember playing the Mahler Fifth in Carnegie Hall the first time, you know, same thing, you know, just not, you know, not understanding how I got there, how I ended up doing all this. And yeah, there's so many. Tarangalila Symphony, crazy piece by Messiaen with Esa-Pekka Salonen. Playing my first recital with my wife, I'll never forget that. You know, it's really, yeah, very lucky. Just a band kid, but I'm really a lucky band kid.
Speaking of that, I've heard you reference both the New York Philharmonic and the Chicago Symphony. Mm-hmm. I think Philadelphia at least once too, as a really great band.
Yeah.
How do they feel about that?
Yeah, I think the string players don't really get it. I think they just think, they look at us sort of like plumbers anyway. You know, like we're there to do a job.
But sure, you're there to fix the sink while they're actually making something special.
Right, exactly. Okay. But like mostly just kind of stay out of the way and clean up your mess when you're gone and don't let me see it.
Or we'll call the union on you.
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Yeah.
So you're saying they like it?
They love it.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah, they love it. Nothing makes them happier than to be called a band by a trumpet player, I'm sure.
I'm sure that is a special, special moment for them.
You know, especially the violinists who have practiced, you know, 6 hours a day since they were three to get to that point and to have a trumpet player call them a band.
Yeah. I mean, I could see.
What's more respectful?
I like it. I don't see a problem. I mean,
for me, it's a compliment. Because
sure.
It really is, because for me, you know, band is, without it, I wouldn't be where I am. It teaches kids, like we've talked about, so many important lessons, but it also gives kids a sense of belonging and a sense of identity and a purpose and friendships and camaraderie and all those things. And without it, I mean, I don't know where I would be. I don't know what I would be doing. I'd probably be at a desk somewhere, which is, that's okay, but I'd much rather be doing this.
Riding around in my van?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I want to be clear about what you meant by this. This.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know.
Where does it go from here, honestly?
I don't know if I'll ever ride in a minivan again.
Well, I can't thank you enough. It's just been an honor to have you come and hang out with us on Maestros and Minivans tonight. I know by the time folks see this, the concert will be heralded as a huge success, and we can't all wait to hear that music. And I'm really thankful for you taking the time to come and be with us.
That's my pleasure. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks again.
Thank you, man. Both hands on the wheel.
Oh, yes, sir.